Margaret Brucker read theology at Cambridge University and then was awarded a doctorate of divinity by the Archbishop of Canterbury. She is the founder of what has been described as temple theology, which for a number of reasons has found tremendous resonance among Latter-day Saints. Tremendous resonance, I think she's noticed that. And she is a prolific author. She's written, I don't know what the count is now, 17 books?
18,
sorry.
I'm behind.
You're slow.
But I just brought one of them because I didn't have a box big enough to carry them all. This is one called The Mother of the Lord, which is very relevant, I think, to many of us here. And she has, it's very gracious on the part of both of them to consent to be with us tonight. Stephen Webb is a Catholic theologian. I should say that you're a lay preacher, I believe, in the Methodist Church.
Yeah.
And Stephen Webb is a Catholic theologian, philosopher of religion, who was associated until recently with Wabash College, did his PhD at the University of Chicago, and has now left early to write full-time. And he's a regular contributor to First Things, which is one of my very, very favorite periodicals. He is best known to a Mormon audience because he's written about Mormons, and we're sort of not used to not being kicked when people write about us. So this was kind of stunning to us. Here's a book called Mormon Christianity, What Other Christians Can Learn from the Latter-day Saints, published by Oxford University Press, 12, I think. And this one, you'll marvel at my remarkable powers. I looked on Amazon. This is to be published on August 31st. Anyway, it's called Catholic and Mormon, A Theological Conversation. It's Stephen Webb with Alonzo Gaskill. I haven't managed to read it yet. I just discovered it yesterday and bought it, but I'm excited about it. And let's see, what else do I need to say? Probably not much. What I wanted to do was to ask the two of you, whoever wants to go first can go first, to say sort of, if you were to characterize your thought, your approach to things, what it is that really makes you tick.
I think he
theologically.
Should go first, then I shall know the sort of answer to give. Okay.
If you would do that, to introduce yourselves to this audience, then we've asked for questions to be sent up in writing. I've only got four, I think, now. So if there are more,
five.
I'll take five. Okay, that's a 25% increase. Very rapid.
I might have.
If we continue at this pace.
I might still have the questions left over from yesterday.
Oh, okay. So. Well, if you would be willing, you've been volunteered to go first.
Oh, okay.
So if you'd like to say something, just briefly.
All right. How briefly, and what do you want me to say?
Just kind of. Why would you be here in Utah? Why would people find you interesting in this community? And what is it that animates your overall thought?
I'm a theologian, and I started studying Mormonism maybe 6-7 years ago. Seriously, I'd known about it before, and I wrote a piece for First Things magazine called Mormonism Obsessed with Christ. They gave it that title. The piece, it's kind of an odd title, I think, but editors do that. The only thing editors do that I know of is they correct your passive voice and they retitle your essay. So, and then they make more money than you do on the journal. But the piece was a defense of the Mormon devotion to and theology of Jesus. And it got so many responses that for Mormons, enormous outpouring of encouragement, and in fact, some of the people that responded are friends of mine to this day, and from other non-Mormon Christians, you know, this is an issue that still rankles a lot of people, but it opened my eyes to the need to explore that topic further. And I guess that got the ball rolling. I mean, the story's a little bit more complicated than that, but for purposes of a brief, that got the ball rolling, and I've been blessed to come out to BYU. Jack Welch and others have invited me out here several times and to give talks, and I've written the two books, and I think of myself as I said Friday, how many were here on Friday who heard me talk? Well, then I don't need to say anything more. I said quite a bit on Friday. Studying Mormonism, you know, it's made me a better Christian. It's made me a better man. It's made me a better theologian. Every step of the way in my journey of taking Joseph seriously and thinking through his theological vision and the development of Christian thought in the Latter-day Saints has just deepened my own convictions or challenged me in ways that have transformed me. And I just continue to be a listener to Joseph and continue to be blessed by it. And so written these two books and have more in mind, and a couple articles I'll be sending your way, I think, Dan, at some point. So, but thanks for having me out here. It's been a lot of fun.
Okay. What makes me tick? Well, that's a very interesting question. Perhaps how did I get into all this? Well, like, the answer is I've been fascinated by the Bible since I was a little girl. And I was given a Bible picture book when I was 8 years old. I was given my first real Bible, an authorized version, when I was 10 years old. And I still have it. I still use it. And it just was always my interest. And with the money I had for my 13th birthday, and you'll think, oh my goodness, what a dreadful child, I bought myself Teach Yourself Hebrew. And the rest is history. The bad side of Teach Yourself Hebrew is you get some awful habits. And when you try to, you know, clean up your Hebrew, these awful weeds still kind of come up through the pavement. I read theology at Cambridge, as Dan said. Opted not to go into academe because I wanted freedom. And so in the years when I was earning a living and supporting a family, I taught mathematics, which is my other subject, but I always kept time for this, which was my hobby. And once you start on something like this, you know, it's a lifetime's addiction. And, you know, if the Lord spares me, I shall continue.
Maybe I'll just tell a quick story. I remember when I first ran across a book by Margaret Barker. It was at the ARSBL, this enormous academic meeting. And the best thing about it to me is the book sales, the book displays. They're enormous, and things are discounted tremendously. And I went to one of the stalls, and they were selling a book on a shelf of books. One of them was called The Great Angel by Margaret Barker. And I thought, oh, now this looks intriguing. And it was 50% off, so what's not to like? So I took it home, and I didn't get to it for a while. And then one night, I remember it was sort of glowing on the bookshelf, you know, read me, read me. And I pulled it down and began to read. And I remember thinking, and this may shock you, I remember thinking, she's got to be a Mormon. And I, no, she can't be. Yes, she is. She has to be. There were so many things in it that really resonated with me. I've used that word before, but it was stunning to me. And I remember telling people, you just got to have a look at this. This is amazing material. So it was really exciting, a really exciting discovery for me. And it's been that way for others. And Stephen Webb, of course, Mormons love to hear people who take us seriously and love to hear people who take Joseph Smith seriously. And so that means a lot to us. Now, we've asked some questions to be turned in. There still aren't very many. But maybe we can start off. Who would like to start? We've got four or five.
Well, I started first. It's your
turn. So it's all right. Okay. Well, I have one here. Nice, clear writing. Which came first, your hypothesis that the Holy Ghost is female, or did your research lead you to that conclusion? Well, in fact, what came first was Hebrew grammar. And in Hebrew, the word for spirit is feminine. And so the natural way to read the Hebrew scriptures is to read the spirit as a feminine entity. And then when you start reading it, you know, consciously like that, all sorts of passages in the Hebrew scriptures suddenly take on a different shade of meaning. And then I took this through into some parts of the New Testament. Of course, the New Testament's in Greek. And in Greek, the word for spirit is a neuter word. It's neither male nor female. But quite a lot of Bible translations in English decide that it's got to be he or his. And then, of course, when you get to Latin becoming a great language of the church, spirit is Latin, in Latin is a masculine noun. So the original feminine spirit of just ordinary Hebrew grammar has disappeared. What got me very angry when I started looking consciously for this in the Hebrew scriptures and then how they're translated into English is that in, for example, the book of the prophet Malachi, the sun rises with healing in her wings. This is one of the images of the Holy Spirit. And it says quite clearly, the Son of Righteousness rises with healing in her wings. And the translations say his wings. And the Hebrew does not say his wings, it says her wings. So you've got bad translations. And all this, you know, edifice of stuff, if you just say, what about reading the Hebrew accurately? And these edifices come crumbling down. Okay, so my research, in a way, confirmed that it was right to read the Hebrew carefully. Okay.
How would a Catholic respond to a naturalist worldview differ from a Mormon response? Or is this an either or a, all right, if you were going to make a presentation similar to Dan Peterson's concluding comments yesterday, the secular argument for the gospel, what would it look like? You would have to remind me what your concluding comments were. How would a Catholic response to a naturalistic worldview differ from a Mormon response? Well, first of all, the similarities. I mean, I think Catholicism and Mormonism are both deeply material religions. The Catholic term for that is a sacramental worldview. In other words, grace is mediated to us by things. And, of course, since Vatican II in the early 1960s, Catholicism has modernized. You could say it's become a little bit more Protestantized. It's liberalized in some ways. But traditionally speaking, the Catholic worldview, the Catholic approach to Christianity has been very naturalistic. I mean, you think of pilgrimages, you think about relics, you think about you think about the sacraments themselves. The bread and the wine can be the means of the immediate and full presence of the divine. And so the material is not something separated from the spiritual. Now that's on a practical level. On a theoretical level, I think Mormonism actually has a better account of that connection than much Catholic theology. And I think the main reason for that is that Mormonism is much more in debt to, obviously, certain strands of Platonic philosophy, Greek thought, that Catholicism is in debt to that in ways that Mormonism is not. Although I think the story is actually, you know, much more complicated than that, because I think, you know, if you look at Neoplatonism splitting into a more, into a theurgic, we're going to get a little technical here, but I think Mormonism too has its roots in ancient philosophy. And I think Joseph restored not only the church, or it was giving us a broad Catholic, if you will, Catholic meaning universal vision of Christianity, but he also was trying to restore the whole of Western thought. And so I think it's probably selling him a little short to say that he wasn't also restoring knowledge, restoring the way we think about the world. And so I think that sometimes the view is that, well, Catholicism borrows too heavily from the Greeks and too heavily from philosophy, and Mormonism doesn't. I think that sells Joseph a little bit short. I think Joseph, too, was, in his own kind of intuitive way, was deeply aware of a certain way of doing philosophy. But his way of thinking about the world, his metaphysics, if you will, definitely bridges the spirit and matter in more creative and in more immediate ways than the Catholic version of that. And, you know, we could talk about this all day, obviously, but Thomas Aquinas plays a big role here. But there is a way in which the Greek tradition thought of the divine that ended up removing the divine from time and space in a way that Joseph didn't. And so I think that the Catholic tradition has a lot to learn from the way that Mormonism holds together spirit and matter, holds together the natural and the supernatural in ways that sometimes fall apart in Catholicism. Although, just to repeat myself, I think on a practical level, the similarities are really striking.
You have another one.
Right. Now, this one, in the same handwriting as the first one, that's called text criticism. The question is, what are the three most compelling evidences, in your opinion, that we have a mother in heaven? Now, I don't actually think like that. I don't think, so these are my three propositions. So I will answer that question in my way. If you start with the central vision of the book of Revelation, and that's the vision in Revelation chapter 12, which is bang in the middle of the book. And there you have the statement at the beginning of the chapter. You've got the mother in heaven giving birth to her son. This is the Messiah, and he goes up and he's set on the throne of God. And at the end of the chapter, you hear that the mother has other children. And these other children are clearly the Christians. Now, from that starting point, and this is where I start a lot of my work on the Mother in Heaven, the way I think is that I take the little details of that image and so forth, and I pursue them like a net or like a web, backwards into the Old Testament, forwards into early Christian writings, sideways into the text that didn't quite get into the canon, things like that. And so I work not by saying point one, point two, point three, but by saying, let's explore and see where these interesting little threads go. Now, one of the things that I like to do is embroidery. And ladies, if you know embroidery, you know it's very easy to get your embroidery wools into a tangle. And how do you disentangle them? You pull one end of the tangle, you see a bit moving at the other end of the lump, and you pull it through. And that could be described as my research method. You start somewhere and you say, ah, isn't that interesting? Can we get from A to B? And invariably, we can. And so I couldn't give you three most compelling evidences, but I can say, if you start with that vision, which is in the center of the Christian apocalypse, and you can follow little threads this way, little threads that way. And after doing this for a while, you realize that you can't possibly read the scriptures in any other way. So it's just simply a different way of looking at and reading what we've got there. It's there, you read carefully, and you translate honestly, and you say, well, how on earth did we lose sight of her? Well, she's there.
Thank you. I think you
understand. What is your view of Joseph Smith's teaching that intelligence are eternal? Boy, there's no softballs here, are there? These are some of the great mysteries of any theology and philosophy. And one of the amazing things about Joseph is he just went right to the heart. I mean, there was a boldness there. I mean, he did not back down from any thought or any intellectual challenge. And he had a vision of eternity and the divine that seemed itself to be kind of boundless and eternal. And so his teaching of the eternity of intelligence is a difficult one. And I know from my reading on this that there are different views of what he meant by this. But I think it's interesting, again, to draw a continuity between Joseph and ancient philosophy rather than to see him as being innovative here. I mean, the great breakthrough in Greek philosophy, what makes philosophy philosophy is the acknowledgement that our thinking is eternal. I mean, what it means to think is to think something that's true, and truths are unchanging. Truths are true for everybody at all times and all places. You know, when the pre-Socratics and when Socrates and Plato started, and Pythagoras, when Pythagoras started thinking about numbers or the definition of a triangle, I mean, there's no triangle in nature. There are things that look triangular, but the definition of a triangle is an abstract idea. And once you have it, it's an idea anybody can have, right? And it's an idea that doesn't change. And so the eternity of intelligence is actually something that is kind of at the birth of the wonder of thinking, of what it means to be human, be a rational person. And of course, for Plato, it also meant that you're participating in the divine, because something that's true must be thought by someone. It has to be thought by God, and it has to be, then you are yourself participating in a truth that's greater than you. And so your mind that perceives the truth is actually transcending your body, transcending your senses, which are not as trustworthy as your mind. They give us little truths about changing things, but not capital T truth about unchanging things. And so you are participating in something that's eternal. You're participating in eternal forms. And of course, all of Western philosophy is basically a debate about this, right? I mean, what does it mean to say something is true, to have a warranted assertion? And what, and the truth that you claim to know, is it like a form? Is it eternal? Is it something that can change? Can your cognition of it change and it's still the truth? And I mean, so this is basically the history of philosophy. Now, what amazes me about Joseph is that he had, you know, he had firm convictions about this that were deep and mysterious and challenging. And I don't think we should, you know, hesitate to see these convictions, some of these teachings, as challenging. So the idea that intelligences are eternal, I think, is in, on one level, his way of acknowledging the eternity in each of us, right? In our spirits or souls or our minds. But of course, he does two things that are different from the tradition before him. He thinks of the spirit or the soul as not necessarily a immaterial entity, and he thinks of eternity as not necessarily timeless. And so when he puts intelligences back into eternity, he does so in a way that changes the picture from Plato. But see, it's also in continuity with Greek thought. I mean, he's not doing something radically different. He's trying to restore the insight into the eternity of truth. He's trying to give it a more naturalistic basis in the sense of seeing our own personages as fully natural. The soul is not something kind of alien to the body, but is a natural aspect of the body. And he's trying to see eternity itself as something that is capable of change, something that has progression built into it. And that does open up a whole interesting way of thinking of eternity and intelligence. To hear more of what I say about that, you have to buy one of my books. So.
Well, we have this one on the yellow card, question for both. This is a different handwriting. And the question actually says, what do you see as the role of the temple for Catholics? Now, I can't speak for Catholics, so I will answer that question, the role of the temple for Christians, more broadly. I think, and this comes to me more and more as I do my research, that this is the great lost framework for Christian thought, Christian liturgy, Christian lifestyle. And I, many, many times when I have been working on a particular temple topic, this or that, I have been brought up quite short by friends. I have many friends in the Orthodox Church. And I'll give you just a couple of examples to illustrate the point that I think the traditional churches have kept a lot of temple structures and ideas and all sorts of things without realizing where they came from. For example, some years ago now, when I was first beginning to work on the female figure that I call the Lady of the Temple, and I had collected together a whole lot of images that are used about her in various Hebrew texts and slightly non-canonical texts, things like that. And I went up to visit a very dear friend of mine who was at the time, David Melling, editing an Orthodox encyclopedia. So somebody who knew a great deal about the Orthodox Church. He was himself an Orthodox Christian. And I was telling him about all these titles for the lady, and suddenly he shot up out of his chair and pulled a book down from the shelf, and it was one of his prayer books. And he said, do you know this? And it was a wonderful Byzantine hymn for Mary called the Akathistos. And he said, look at it. And I skimmed through it And this was a great hymn of praise to Mary. Hail, and then all these titles. And all the titles that I had identified as titles of the lady, and I mean all of them, had come through into that Byzantine hymn for Mary. Now he, the writer of the Orthodox Encyclopedia, had no idea where those titles had come from, and I had no idea at that time where the titles had gone. And so we built a little bridge. Now, much more recently, the same thing, that this temple stuff is there in the traditional church, in this case the Orthodox Church. I had been doing another patch of work on the lady, and I had been exploring the image of the lady and her golden net. And I was talking about this to another Orthodox Christian friend, and he said, oh my goodness, yes, that's our something or other prayer for Pentecost. Can't remember it exactly, I'll email it to you. And there it was, the image of the Spirit coming down with a net at Pentecost. They had it in their traditional ancient prayers. I had come to that conclusion after literally weeks of really quite hard research. And I thought, wow, I've made a discovery. And they said, oh, we've had it all the time. So, but they didn't know where it had come from. And again, I didn't know where it had gone. So what do you see as the role of the temple for Christians, traditional Christians? I think a lot of us have more of it than we realize. That's your turn.
Yeah, you know, the Protestant reformers tended to think of Catholic churches as temples. And wanted to cleanse the temples. So one of the great revolutions in Europe was the cleansing of the temples, was the ransacking of Catholic churches, because Protestants believed that the worship of God should be more biblically based, and it shouldn't involve the appeal to the eye, and that statuary smacked of pagan idols. And that many of the accoutrements of the Catholic churches came too close to temple furniture. I mean, after all, Catholic churches, even to this day, have altar tables. They use incense, although that's increasingly rare. But they're, you know, priestly garments. And so I think this is one of those ways, the whole role of the temple is one of those ways that if you look at Mormonism through Protestant eyes, then Mormonism and Catholicism seem a little bit odd. And I think that, you know, we all need to recognize Protestantism as being kind of the odd man out. And if you look at Mormonism through Catholic eyes, then not only does more Mormonism make sense, but you also have a richer conversation. And so, yeah, I mean, Catholics, I think, have a strong sense of the continuity between the church and the temple. Although I also say that, of course, when Christianity was legalized in the Roman Empire, it's the basilica that became the architectural standard for the Catholic Church, a big hall, basically, a big public meeting place. And I was in a temple for a Mormon temple for the first time. I was fortunate enough to have a tour of the Indianapolis Temple during its opening, before its consecration a couple weeks ago. And it was a real blessing. I had not been in a temple, Mormon temple, before. And one of the things that struck me, you know, is the intimacy and the family-orientedness, you know, the way the Mormon temple is constructed as, you know, rooms to, you know, to make your progression through these rooms as a group and to be with family in the ceiling and the intimacy of those spaces, you know, they were very domestic, whereas the Catholic cathedrals or your typical Catholic church tends to be, you know, large and open upwards. So the emphasis, and you can kind of see the different theological emphases there, you know, the openness upwards to a God that's beyond, or the kind of gathering together in a series of familial rooms for reconnecting and reconnecting through building up relationships that goes on in the Mormon temple. But yeah.
Thank you. Let me just interpose a comment. Just as a matter of order here, I don't want to keep them too long. I know it's 7:54 and they both have flights tomorrow, including one very long one tomorrow. So we're going to try to get them out of here fairly quickly. So we'll just do these next few questions, I think.
Finish at quarter past eight. So
yeah,
by
she needs to leave by quarter past eight.
Yeah.
We would. I know there's been one request, and this is a big group.
If we could very quickly at the very end of this gather up, Jeff, do you still want? Where are you, Jeff? You still want to do a photograph?
Yes.
Okay, we can do that.
Rush to the back.
We'll rush to the back.
Tall
we'll,
ones at the back, short ones at the front.
Yeah, yeah. We'll get organized very quickly. Okay. Yeah. Anyway.
Right. Is it me?
Yeah.
Well, I've got a blue one, different handwriting again. It says, you have published on the Book of Mormon and pre-exilic Israelite religion. Well, that's not quite true. I have published on pre-exilic Israelite religion, and a lot of my LDS friends have said, oh my goodness, we recognize this. So the second part of the question I can answer. Can you comment on how you think the Book of Mormon came to have so many ancient ideas in it? The answer is no, but I am constantly amazed at how many times when I come up with something which I think is the result of, you know, the normal processes of applying scholarly tools to ancient texts, and I might send the idea, for example, to my dear friend Kevin Christensen, who is here, and he will email me back saying, oh, we've got that too. So, and so that's the level at which this, you know, the children's game of playing snap, when you put the two cards out, when the two pictures match, you say snap. That is this very sophisticated scholarly method that we have used. I have been working simply on the texts where I'm competent to handle them, you know, the ancient Hebrew texts and the environing non-canonical texts and so forth, and the Jewish tradition of interpretation. And I come up with something, and Kevin comes back and said, oh, yes, we've got this. So I have no idea how we have so much correspondence, but it's very interesting, isn't it?
Thank you.
Yeah. Well, there are a couple of good questions to choose from here. I'm kind of paralyzed, but Mormon materialism, where did Joseph's theology come from? He was a semi-literate bumpkin. I didn't say that. I think that's the key question. I mean, he either was a religious genius who had insight into divinization, for example. I mean, that's a topic that is just now becoming prominent in theological circles. Really, when I was in graduate school 30 years ago, even in Catholic and Eastern Orthodox circles, the idea that theosis, it's called, or the divinization, the idea that we'll be like God or share in God's being in some way in the afterlife, we will become gods ourselves in a way. This was something that was not in any theological agenda. Now it's all over the place. There are just books galore written about it, trying to retrieve divinization as a part of the Christian heritage. And people are recognizing that even Luther had some version of it, but certainly early theologians and up through Aquinas and beyond had versions of divinization. And here's Joseph Smith, basically developing a full-fledged view of divinization in New York and Ohio and Illinois in the 1820s and 30s. But you could actually go on and on, you know, on a whole series of these topics. So he had a remarkable way of intuiting things that he thought were lacking in the Christianity of his time. And he had a way of filling in those gaps with resources or aspects of the Christian tradition that most people in his time and even many people today were not aware of. And so it's unclear. I think fortunately, I'm not a historian. I don't have to answer, well, how did all that work? But one of my missions is to bring Joseph into mainstream theology, if you will, as a theological visionary who, first of all, should be read and enjoyed and appreciated for his vision of Jesus, his devotion to our Lord, his views of heaven, his views on a whole host, a whole range of a number of things, but also to be grappled with in terms of how he revises certain Christian doctrines and relocates them and nudges them and in some cases transforms them. And so I always think it's, to speak to non-Mormons, as a theologian, speaking to non-Mormon theologians, that's how I always like to start. You know, and I like to start by prompting them to see the richness and complexity of Joseph's thought, which they probably hadn't thought of before. And then, of course, if you get hooked on that, then you do have to, I suppose, at the end of the day, at some point, say, well, what was the ultimate source of that? And right now I'm trying to figure out if you can accept Joseph as a kind of prophet who spoke truth on many issues without necessarily becoming a full-fledged member of the Mormon Church. I think it's probably important to stake that out, that being a student, more than just a historical student, but being a theological student, a fellow traveler, if you will, of Mormonism, or someone who wants to learn from Joseph, you can do that without necessarily, the risk is you'll end up converting, and that's probably a good thing, but that you can do that without necessarily having conversion on the table at all times, because there's so much beauty there, and there's so much richness there, that I think to draw people into that and to create that kind of conversation. And so Joseph was, for me, I do call him a prophet. And I do think he was inspired by God. And can you say that and not be a Mormon? I hope so. I think so. I think you can. But maybe some of my fellow Catholics think you can't. So if this tape gets out to the wider audience, but I'm not employed by the Catholic Church. I don't teach at a Catholic school, so I have a certain freedom there. But that's where I'm at right now. Thanks.
Thank you. Do you have one?
Okay. Now, this is an interesting one. What is your view of the Trinity if members of it can be of different gender? That's interesting. That's really a question about theological language, because human beings are limited by the words we use to try and express our thoughts. And I think by emphasizing, you know, with the limitations of human language, that, for example, the spirit should be thought of as feminine, that's not just the result of Hebrew grammar. I think the positive thing for that is to remind us that the unity of the Trinity is not masculine. Beyond this world of limitations of human experience and human language, where we think in terms of male and female, that's what we get in Genesis chapter 1, the image of God is created as male and female. And it's very easy in the way theological language has developed to forget the fact that the whole of humanity, the male bit and the female bit, is in the image of God. And by having the Holy Spirit as, in terms of human language, a feminine presence, that is a constant reminder that the Trinity and the unity of the Trinity is not defined as a masculine thing. It is beyond gender. But in the past, people have said beyond gender, but it's still three fellows. And that's doublethink, and it won't do. And once you bring back, you know, a touch of Hebrew grammar and a touch of humility, and just reading the first page of Genesis, you realize you've got to have an element of the feminine in the divine.
Do any Catholic scholars address the saints and relics in the context of our cognitive predispositions to anthropomorphism? That's an interesting question, because there have been studies in, both by theologians, philosophers, and social scientists about the anthropomorphic shape of our thinking of the divine. There are various studies of this and various ways of thinking about it. One way to think about it is historically, that so anthropomorphic just means human form, thinking of God in a human form. And this was the dominant way of thinking about God. Even it's taken Bible scholars a long time to admit this, but you know, the Hebraic Bible is deeply anthropomorphic, although there's still debates about this, and early Christians were deeply anthropomorphic. And it wasn't really until Origen, a third century philosopher, and then even more so with Augustine and subsequent philosophers, that the idea that God is not anthropomorphic took root in Christianity. So, but there are cognitive scientists who argue that there is a natural inclination in us to anthropomorphize. That when we hear a sound, we think there's someone there. We give agency to the sound. You know, when you look at a cloud, you try to find a shape in it. you know. And so when you have a relationship to a pet dog, you tend to think the dog thinks like you do, whether it really does or not. And, you know, there are all these different ways of talking about this. But certainly I tend to think that it is impossible not to think of God anthropomorphically. But it's also true that the great sweep of Christian theology has been an attempt to show or to argue that it is important to overcome your anthropomorphic views of God. And the way to do this is through what's commonly called negative theology. You negate your ideas or your images of God. And also through analogy, you treat your images of God as analogical. And the problem with these is that you end up with a God who is very hard to make any sense of, because the more you negate and the more you treat everything you know as an analogy, then you end up with no images of God, and you end up with God being the, you know, the ground of being, or being itself, or the one, or the singular, or pure action, or pure simplicity. And I don't want to put down those moves, because those kinds of arguments are really rich, right? I mean, this is in some sense the high points of medieval theology and philosophy. But I think more and more theologians and philosophers are realizing that analogy doesn't work. It doesn't give us much information. It doesn't give us much God to hang on to, so to speak. And the way to solve that is, I think, again, the way Joseph took, which is to think of God as really being embodied in some way. Now, that's still mysterious, right? I mean, God's body must be very different from our own. Joseph said matter in the spirit state is refined, and refinement is a metaphor, right? I mean, it's not like matter goes through a sifting machine to get the grains, to get the metal out of a grain or something. I mean, refinement is something that happens through death and through the grace of Christ and our joining with Christ in our resurrected bodies. But the idea that God is material, I think, and has a form, is for me the most radical thing that Joseph taught. But it's also something that makes sense. And it's something that I'm sure to still a lot of non-Mormons it seems unfamiliar and off-putting, but there's actually a lot of richness in that and a lot of truth in what Joseph taught about God. And so this is one of the things that I keep returning to over and over, and I'll keep writing about in future articles and books, I hope.
Thank you. Do you have another one? I think you do.
Hmm? Yeah. This is a question about something that we're involved in. I need to give a bit of background. I know who asked this question. I won't name him. Can we expect anything forthcoming from the Center for the Study of the Jordanian-led books in the near future? Well, first of all, define the near future. Scholars can't work quickly. Some of you, most of you, will never have heard of this august body, the Center for the Study of the Jordanian-led books. Been a very controversial find in Jordan of some little lead books. A lot of controversy over it. A group of scholars based in London decided to set themselves up as a centre for the proper investigation and testing of these things. And this has been a long process. We are now established as a not-for-profit company registered in England. That takes ages, all the bits of paper you have to collect together. We have got a board, all duly registered. We have an evaluation panel comprising metallurgist and Hebraist, all distinguished in their field. We are working on these books. We plan to make public our first report on the 26th of May next year. Now, that is our plan. That's what we're working to. Who knows what might happen between now and then, but certainly that is so far on schedule. We've got 6 Hebraists working on it, all, you know, at the top of the tree, and some very more than competent metallurgists. But these things can't be rushed. We're working in a completely unknown area, hitherto unknown area. We're working slowly, we're working cautiously, and we shall publish, we hope, on the 26th of May next year.
Thank you. Have you gone through all your questions?
One more. Should I do it or not?
Go ahead.
Could you speculate about any common origins for the Catholic Mass and Mormon temple endowment? I'm not an expert on early Christian liturgy, but just to say a couple of things. First of all, the Catholic initiation ceremonies, the Christian initiation ceremonies in the early centuries of the church were also private. The catechumens would stay for the first half of the liturgy, they would leave for the second, and usually once a year then they would be initiated into the church, and that service was absolutely secret or private, if you will. And so, you know, in the minds of some people, you know, the idea that, you know, Mormon temples would be private or for members only is bothersome to our democratic society, you know, where everything needs to be accessible at all times. But to the Catholic mind, it shouldn't be, because the idea that there's a time and a place that's set apart for a deep mystery that is for the faithful alone is something that was very common, very much built into the early liturgy of the church. And the second thing I'll say is that the early initiation ceremonies were very much about movement from room to room, the use of light, and the use of garment. Some of you probably know that some descriptions of some of the early liturgies, the baptism would take place in the nude, and then a white garment would be given to the newly baptized. So yeah, I think there are some really interesting parallels there, and that's something I actually want to look into further. Thanks.
I think you've done yours.
I think I've done mine. Yes.
Okay. Well, I think we've gone through the questions, and I really appreciate this. I hope you've enjoyed this little discussion as much as I have. It might be appropriate to give a round of applause.
And now the photo.
Yes, now the photo.